Senator Cotton, thank you as well also for your constant willingness to press this committee and, frankly, the IC leadership to make sure both on the unclassified and classified section, the collaboration between the DOD projects and the IC projects. Senator Cotton.
Thank you. Director Haynes, I want to address the administration's fiasco of failing to help Poland transfer its aircraft to Ukraine. The Pentagon spokesman yesterday cited your intelligence community. Quote, the intelligence community has assessed the transfer of MiG-29s to Ukraine may be mistaken as escalatory and could result in significant Russian reaction that might increase the prospects of a military escalation with NATO. The State Department spokesman said essentially the same thing earlier today. Since administration policymakers are justifying their hesitancy to help Poland transfer these aircraft by pointing to your intelligence community, could you tell us what is the basis for this alleged assessment that the transfer of these aircraft would be viewed as escalatory?
Thank you, Senator Cotton. So it is our analyst's assessment that the transfer of these airplanes could be perceived as a significant escalation by the Russians. It is, they are obviously an advanced and considerable weapon.
Director, I'm sorry.
Yeah,
so
please.
I appreciate your analysts and their deep expertise and knowledge about this.
Absolutely.
I'm asking what specific evidence, information, intelligence do they have that the transfer of these aircrafts, as opposed to anti-aircraft missiles that shoot Russian jets out of the sky, is going to be viewed as escalatory?
Why don't I provide to you a written product that will give you the basis for that?
So the Pentagon spokesman also said that this is the same intelligence that they had last year that delayed the transfer of many of those missiles as well, that there's no new intelligence. He said it was the same intelligence he's had last year. Is that the case?
No, Senator, I'm not aware of what it is that he was referencing, but this is a recent assessment that was done by the intelligence community. I'm very happy to provide that to you.
Assessments. I'm saying, do you have new intelligence?
So when analysts, I mean, I know you know this, but obviously they're looking at a body of intelligence, and then they're also providing their own knowledge and experience, and I don't know whether or not there is.
So we can address this in a closed setting, but here's my opinion. You don't have new intelligence. This is opinion, and in many cases, this is policymakers who are looking to the intelligence community to provide them cover for their hesitancy. General Barrier, could you explain, as an intelligence officer, how Vladimir Putin might be A-okay with us transferring missiles that turn their tanks into burning piles of rubbish or shoot their jets out of the sky, yet transferring tactical aircraft is going to be unacceptable? Why is the latter escalatory and the former not escalatory?
Senator Cotton, thank you. I will take a stab at that in open session here. I think when you look at anti-tank weapons and air defense shoulder-fired kinds of weapons, there is a range of escalation. And I think in our view, that escalation ladder doesn't get checked higher with those weapons versus something like combat aircraft.
I got to say, I don't think there's a lot of common sense between this distinction, and a lot of farmers in Arkansas wouldn't understand it either. I mean, your own written assessment, Ms. Haynes, says that Russia, quote, doesn't want a direct conflict with the United States, end quote. That was from January 21st that assessment said Russia doesn't want a conflict with the United States. You think they're more likely to want a conflict now after Vladimir Putin has seen the performance of his army? Not just against the Ukrainian army, but with moms with Molotov cocktails and grandmas with AK-47s. You think they're more likely to want a piece of us now than they were 2 months ago?
I don't think it's an issue of whether or not they're more likely to want a conflict. It's whether or not they perceive us as being in that conflict with them. I think we're in a very challenging position, right, where we are obviously providing enormous amounts of support to the Ukrainians, as we should and need to do, but at the same time, trying not to escalate the conflict into a full-on NATO or U.S. war with Russia. And that's a challenging space to manage. And the analysts, I think, are just trying to provide their best assessment of what is likely to be perceived as that kind of escalation in this circumstance.
Well, I mean, I've got to say, it seems to me that Vladimir Putin simply deterred the U.S. government from providing these aircraft by saying they would view this as escalatory. And if that's going to be our position, I mean, we might as well call the commanding general at Fort Lewis outside Seattle and tell him to take the flag down and surrender our position, because he's not going to stop in Ukraine, he's not going to stop in Europe, he's going to go all the way to the West Coast. And every time he raises a threat, we immediately back off. One other question I want to ask in this area as well about intelligence sharing. Last Thursday, the House Armed Services Committee Chairman Adam Smith said, quote, we are providing some intelligence. We're not providing the kind of real-time targeting because that, you know, steps over the line that makes us participate in the war, end quote. Just a few hours later, the White House press secretary contradicted him, saying, we have consistently been sharing intelligence that includes information the Ukrainians can use to inform and develop their military response to Russia's invasion. That has been ongoing, and reports that suggest otherwise are inaccurate. So who is correct, the Democratic chairman of the House Armed Services Committee or the White House press secretary? Are we or are we not providing that kind of real-time targeting intelligence to Ukraine?
We are providing an enormous amount of intelligence to Ukraine. I'd be happy to get into, in closed sessions, the details of what we're providing. And I think maybe if there's anything else that people would like to
add. Can you at least tell me who is correct between the chairman of the House Armed Services Committee and the White House press secretary?
Honestly, Senator, I think getting into this in closed session would be easier so that we can actually explain to you what it is that we're providing. But I'm happy to defer to my colleagues who may have additional.
I'm sure we'll address it in closed session.
Thank you, Senator Cotton.
Senator Burr raised an excellent point. It's a second arbitrary distinction about these Polish MiGs. Apparently, the U.S. government position was they go from Poland, okie dokie, that's A-OK. They go from the United States? Nope. Vladimir Putin views that as escalatory. I still don't think there's any intelligence to justify that distinction. I want to return, General Barrett, to what you said, Senator Sass. You said that you believe that there is a difference in escalation between anti-tank missiles and anti-aircraft missiles on the one hand and aircraft on the other hand. I understand you believe that. I understand that Director Haines believes that, and she claims that the analysts believe that. I don't believe it. I don't believe it, and I don't believe there's intelligence to support it. I bet the Russian pilot that gets shot out of the air by an anti-aircraft missile as opposed to an aircraft doesn't believe it either. But it's not really a matter of what you believe or I believe. It's a matter of what we can prove and what we can prove that Vladimir Putin believes. And I just don't think the proof is there. We'll know in a few minutes, I guess, if there is. I want to address a bigger point, and I want to join with a lot of my colleagues to commend the intelligence community, and especially the DIA, for the outstanding work it did leading up to the invasion. It's the best I've seen the intelligence community perform in my 7 years on the committee, from September until February 24th. Director Haines, you testify that you think Vladimir Putin underestimated the Ukrainians' skill and their will to fight, and he overestimated his own military's ability. Is it fair to say our intelligence community made the same mistakes based on the testimony we've heard here?
So we assessed prior to the invasion that he was underestimating the Ukrainians' essentially resistance, likely resistance to it. So I think we did well there. We did not do as well in terms of predicting the military challenges that he has encountered with his own military.
General Barrett, could you address this?
Senator Cotton, I will address that. My view was that based on a variety of factors, that the Ukrainians were not as ready as I thought they should be. Therefore, I question their will to fight. That was a bad assessment on my part because they have fought bravely and honorably and are doing the right thing. So that was an issue for me as the director of DIA.
And I understand that assessing a people's will to fight is one of the hardest things an intelligence agency could do. It's, in some ways, it's a moral or psychological question, not an intelligence question. But in other things, like how long Kyiv would hold out, or these other major cities, or how long Ukraine would still have an air force or air defense systems, did we make mistakes about those assessments as well?
Well, we made some assumptions about his assumptions, which proved to be very, very flawed. And so his actual activity as he got into this fight turned his operation kind of on its head. And what we've seen is a devolvement, if you will, of the operations that he has going on now. And I'd like to save the rest of this for a closed session.
To the extent we can address it here, could you say why you think we made those mistakes?
I think assessing morale and a will to fight is a very difficult analytical task. We had different inputs from different organizations, and we at least from my perspective as a director, I did not do as well as I could have.
Director Haynes, could you give your opinion on why the IC made those mistakes?
I don't think I have anything to add in open session. I'm trying to, we can discuss further.
Okay. I just want to say, because I just don't want to be critical, but these mistakes had potentially real-world policy implications about the willingness of the president or other NATO leaders to provide weapons that they thought might have fallen into the hands of Russians in a matter of hours, or to impose sanctions for something that might have been a fait accompli. And we need to ask ourselves, if we made mistakes about the first 2 weeks of this war, are we making mistakes about the next 2 weeks or the next 2 months, and the policy implications those might have? And furthermore, to Richard Burr's point about the use of policy to influence intelligence, I have to say I have concerns that part of the reason the administration went relatively soft on Russia and was hesitant in Ukraine in 2021 is they were relying on Russia to get the bad nuclear deal that Susan Collins was talking about. I have the unavoidable conclusion that influenced part of it.